Part 2 of Chapter 1 of The Exploits of Brigadier Gerard by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Duroc gave a shout like the sportsman who sees his game rising in front of him. The lad seemed to have gone off his head, his eyes shining, his face deathly white, and such a grim set about his mouth as made the farmer shrink away from him. I can see him now, leaning forward on his brown horse with his eager gaze fixed upon the great black tower. "Why do you call it the Castle of Gloom?" I asked. "Well, it's the name it bears upon the countryside," said the farmer. "By all accounts there have been some black doings up yonder. It's not for nothing that the wickedest man in Poland has been living there for 14 years past." "A Polish nobleman?" I asked. "Nay, we breed no such men in Poland," he answered. "A Frenchman, then," cried Duroc. "They say that he came from France." "And with red hair?" "As red as a fox." "Yes, yes, it is my man," cried my companion, quivering all over in his excitement. "It is the hand of Providence which has led me here. Who can say that there is not justice in this world? Come, Monsieur Gerard, for I must see the men safely quartered before I can attend to this private matter." He spurred on his horse, and 10 minutes later we were at the door of the inn of Arensdorf, where his men were to find their quarters for the night. Well, all this was no affair of mine, and I could not imagine what the meaning of it might be. Rossel was still far off, but I determined to ride on for a few hours and take my chance of some wayside barn in which I could find shelter for Rataplan and myself. I had mounted my horse, therefore, after tossing off a cup of wine, when young Duroc came running out of the door and laid his hand upon my knee. "Monsieur Gerard," he panted, "I beg of you not to abandon me like this." "My good sir," said I, "if you would tell me what is the matter, and what you would wish me to do, I should be better able to tell you if I could be of any assistance to you." "You can be of the very greatest," he cried. "Indeed, from all that I have heard of you, Monsieur Gerard, you are the one man whom I should wish to have by my side to-night. You forget that I am riding to join my regiment. You cannot in any case reach it tonight. Tomorrow will bring you to Rossel. By staying with me, you will confer the very greatest kindness upon me. And you will aid me in a matter which concerns my own honour and the honour of my family. I am compelled, however, to confess to you that some personal danger may possibly be involved." It was a crafty thing for him to say. Of course, I sprang from Rataplan's back and ordered the groom to lead him back to the stables. "Come into the inn," said I, "and let me know exactly what it is that you wish me to do." He led the way into a sitting room and fastened the door lest we should be interrupted. He was a well-grown lad, and as he stood in the glare of the lamp, with the light beating upon his earnest face and upon his uniform of silver-grey, which suited him to a marvel, I felt my heart warm towards him. Without going so far as to say that he carried himself as I had done at his age, there was at least similarity enough to make me feel sympathy with him. "I can explain it all in a few words," said he. "If I have not already satisfied your very natural curiosity, it is because the subject is so painful a one to me that I can hardly bring myself to allude to it. I cannot, however, ask for your assistance without explaining to you exactly how the matter lies. You must know, then, that my father was the well-known banker Christophe Duroc, who was murdered by the people during the September massacres. As you are aware, the mob took possession of the prisons, chose 3 so-called judges to pass sentence upon the unhappy aristocrats, and then tore them to pieces when they were passed out into the street. My father had been a benefactor of the poor all his life. There were many to plead for him. He had the fever, too, and was carried in half dead upon a blanket. 2 of the judges were in favour of acquitting him. The 3rd, a young Jacobin, whose huge body and brutal mind had made him a leader among these wretches, dragged him with his own hands from the litter, kicked him again and again with his heavy boots, and hurled him out of the door, where in an instant he was torn limb from limb under circumstances which are too horrible for me to describe. This, as you perceive, was murder, even under their own unlawful laws. for two of their own judges had pronounced in my father's favour. Well, when the days of order came back again, my elder brother began to make inquiries about this man. I was only a child then, but it was a family matter, and it was discussed in my presence. The fellow's name was Caraban. He was one of Sonstare's guard, and a noted duellist. A foreign lady, named the Baroness Straubenthal, having been dragged before the Jacobins, he had gained her liberty for her on the promise that she, with her money and estates, should be his. He had married her, taken her name and title, and escaped out of France at the time of the fall of Robespierre. What had become of him we had no means of learning. You will think, doubtless, that it would be easy for us to find him, since we had both his name and his title. You must remember, however, that the revolution left us without money, and that without money such a search is very difficult. Then came the Empire, and it became more difficult still, for, as you are aware, the Emperor considered that the 18th Brumaire brought all accounts to a settlement, and that on that day a veil had been drawn across the past. Nonetheless, we kept our own family story and our own family plans. My brother joined the army, and passed with it through all southern Europe, asking everywhere for the Baron Straubenthal. Last October he was killed at Jena, with his mission still unfulfilled. Then it became my turn, and I have the good fortune to hear of the very man of whom I am in search at one of the first Polish villages which I have to visit, and within a fortnight of joining my regiment. And then, to make the matter even better, I find myself in the company of one whose name is never mentioned throughout the army, save in connection with some daring and generous deed. This was all very well, and I listened to it with the greatest interest, but I was none the clearer as to what young Duroc wished me to do. "How can I be of service to you?" I asked. "By coming up with me." "To the castle?" "Precisely." "When?" "At once." "But what do you intend to do?" "I shall know what to do. But I wish you to be with me all the same." "Well, it was never in my nature to refuse an adventure, and besides, I had every sympathy with the lad's feelings. It is very well to forgive one's enemies, but one wishes to give them something to forgive also." I held out my hand to him, therefore. "I must be on my way for Rossel tomorrow morning, but tonight I am yours," said I. We left our troopers in snug quarters, and as it was but a mile to the castle, we did not disturb our horses. To tell the truth, I hate to see a cavalryman walk, and I hold that just as he is the most gallant thing upon earth when he has his saddle flaps between his knees, so he is the most clumsy when he has to loop up his sabre and his sabre-tash in one hand, and turn in his toes for fear of catching the rowels of his spurs. Still, Duroc and I were of the age when one can carry things off, and I dare swear that no woman at least would have quarrelled with the appearance of the two young hussars, one in blue and one in grey, who set out that night from the Arensdorf post-house. We both carried our swords, and for my own part, I slipped a pistol from my holster into the inside of my pelisse, for it seemed to me that there might be some wild work before us. The track which led to the castle wound through a pitch-black fir wood, where we could see nothing save the ragged patch of stars above our heads. Presently, however, it opened up, and there was the castle right in front of us, about as far as a carbine would carry. It was a huge, uncouth place, and bore every mark of being exceedingly old, with turrets at every corner, and a square keep on the side which was nearest to us. In all its great shadow there was no sign of light save from a single window, and no sound came from it. To me there was something awful in its size and its silence, which corresponded so well with its sinister name. My companion pressed on eagerly, and I followed him along the ill-kept path which led to the gate. There was no bell or knocker upon the great iron-studded door, and it was only by pounding with the hilts of our sabres that we could attract attention. A thin, hawk-faced man, with a beard up to his temples, opened it at last. He carried a lantern in one hand, and in the other a chain which held an enormous black hound. His manner at the first moment was threatening, but the sight of our uniforms and of our faces turned it into one of sulky reserve. "The Baron Straubenthal does not receive visitors at so late an hour," said he, speaking in very excellent French. "You can inform Baron Straubenthal that I have come 800 leagues to see him, and that I will not leave until I have done so," said my companion. I could not myself have said it with a better voice and manner. The fellow took a sidelong look at us and tugged at his black beard in his perplexity. "To tell the truth, gentlemen," said he, "the Baron has a cup or two of wine in him at this hour, and you would certainly find him a more entertaining companion if you were to come again in the morning." He had opened the door a little wider as he spoke, and I saw by the light of the lamp in the hall behind him that three other rough fellows were standing there, one of whom held another of these monstrous hounds. Duroc must have seen it also, but it made no difference to his resolution. "Enough talk," said he, pushing the man to one side. "It is with your master that I have to deal." The fellows in the hall made way for him as he strode in among them. So great is the power of one man who knows what he wants over several who are not sure of themselves. My companion tapped one of them upon the shoulder with as much assurance as though he owned him. "Show me to the Baron," said he. The man shrugged his shoulders and answered something in Polish. The fellow with the beard, who had shut and barred the front door, appeared to be the only one among them who could speak French. "Well, you shall have your way," said he, with a sinister smile. "You shall see the Baron, and perhaps, before you have finished, you will wish that you had taken my advice." We followed him down the hall, which was stone-flagged and very spacious, with skins scattered upon the floor and the heads of wild beasts upon the walls. At the farther end he threw open a door, and we entered. It was a small room, scantily furnished, with the same marks of neglect and decay which met us at every turn. The walls were hung with discoloured tapestry, which had come loose at one corner so as to expose the rough stonework behind. A second door, hung with a curtain, faced us upon the other side. Between lay a square table, strewn with dirty dishes and the sordid remains of a meal. Several bottles were scattered over it. At the head of it, and facing us, there sat a huge man with a lion-like head and a great shock of orange-coloured hair. His beard was of the same glaring hue, matted and tangled and coarse as a horse's mane. I have seen some strange faces in my time, but never one more brutal than that, with its small, vicious blue eyes, his white crumpled cheeks, and the thick hanging lip which protruded over his monstrous beard. His head swayed about on his shoulders, and he looked at us with the vague, dim gaze of a drunken man. Yet he was not so drunk but that our uniforms carried their message to him. "Well, my brave boys," he hiccuped. "What is the latest news from Paris, eh? You're going to free Poland, I hear, and have meantime all become slaves yourselves, slaves to a little aristocrat with his grey coat and his three-cornered hat. No more citizens either, I am told, and nothing but Monsieur and Madame. My faith, some more heads will have to roll into the sawdust basket some of these mornings." Duroc advanced in silence and stood by the ruffian's side. "Jean Carabin," said he. The Baron started, and the film of drunkenness seemed to be clearing from his eyes. "Jean Carabin," said Duroc once more. He sat up and grasped the arms of his chair. "What do you mean by repeating that name, young man?" he asked. "Jean Carabin, you are a man whom I have long wished to meet." "Supposing that I once had such a name, how can it concern you, since you must have been a child when I bore it?" "My name is Duroc, not the son of the man you murdered." The Baron tried to laugh, but there was terror in his eyes. "We must let bygones be bygones, young man," he cried. "It was our life or theirs in those days, the aristocrats or the people. Your father was of the Gironde. He fell. I was of the mountain. Most of my comrades fell. It was all the fortune of war. We must forget all this and learn to know each other better, you and I." He held out a red, twitching hand as he spoke. "Enough," said young Duroc. "If I were to pass my sabre through you as you sit in that chair, I should do what is just and right. I dishonour my blade by crossing it with yours. And yet you are a Frenchman, and have even held a commission under the same flag as myself. Rise, then, and defend yourself." "Tut, tut!" cried the Baron. "It is all very well for you young bloods." Duroc's patience could stand no more. He swung his open hand into the centre of the great orange beard. I saw a lip fringed with blood and two glaring blue eyes above it. "You shall die for that blow." "That is better," said Duroc. "My sabre!" cried the other. "I will not keep you waiting, I promise you," and he hurried from the room. I have said that there was a second door covered with a curtain. Hardly had the Baron vanished when there ran from behind it a woman, young and beautiful. So swiftly and noiselessly did she move that she was between us in an instant, and it was only the shaking curtains which told us whence she had come. "I have seen it all," she cried. "Oh, sir, you have carried yourself splendidly." She stooped to my companion's hand and kissed it again and again ere he could disengage it from her grasp. "Nay, madame, why should you kiss my hand?" he cried. "Because it is the hand which struck him on his vile, lying mouth. Because it may be the hand which will avenge my mother. I am his stepdaughter. The woman whose heart he broke was my mother. I loathe him. I fear him. Ah, there is his step!" In an instant she had vanished as suddenly as she had come. A moment later the Baron entered with a drawn sword in his hand, and the fellow who had admitted us at his heels. "This is my secretary," said he. "He will be my friend in this affair. But we shall need more elbow room than we can find here. Perhaps you will kindly come with me to a more spacious apartment." It was evidently impossible to fight in a chamber which was blocked by a great table. We followed him out, therefore, into the dimly lit hall. At the farther end, a light was shining through an open door. "We shall find what we want in here," said the man with the dark beard. It was a large, empty room, with rows of barrels and cases round the walls. A strong lamp stood upon a shelf in the corner. The floor was level and true, so that no swordsman could ask for more. Duroc drew his sabre and sprang into it. The Baron stood back with a bow and motioned me to follow my companion. Hardly were my heels over the threshold when the heavy door crashed behind us and the key screamed in the lock. We were taken in a trap. End of part 2 of chapter 1.